गुड इवनिंग स्टूडेंट्स,
गुड इवनिंग सर।
विल गेट स्टार्टेड इन 2 मिनट्स। So we have seen certain topics till now, right? In the second chapter, we have completed some important topics related to electrostatic potential energy, electrostatic potential. Then we did some problems. Also, we saw what is an equipotential surface and the relation between electric field and the potential difference. That is the concept of potential gradient. Also, we saw, right? So, if I have to break this chapter into 2 parts, the first part of the chapter is called as electrostatic potential, and the second part mainly speaks about a device called as a capacitor and the capacitance of that particular device. Okay, so we are at the end of the first part. That is, the last topic that we need to see with respect to a conductor is electrostatics of conductor. So this is the topic we are going to start with. This part I will explain it from the textbook itself. So it's called as electrostatics of conductors. Okay. So if you talk about electric charges and fields, we are mainly studying about the charges at rest only. So when I say charges are at rest, see, this is where the confusion starts. Generally, what will come to your mind when we speak about conductors?
They allow electricity to pass.
When we say conductor,
flow through it.
The extent to which they can allow the charge to flow through it, right? That is what a conductor means. Insulator is a device which will oppose, which will not allow the charge to flow through it. As simple as that, right? So generally, what happens is when we see the word conductors, we forget to see what is the prefix of it. Here we are going to discuss about the electrostatics of conductors. Means, in this context, our interest of study is not about how the charges are going to flow within the conductor. It's all about how the charges are going to be present in static condition in a conductor. Okay, that is, if a conductor is given charge, will it be able to hold it? Will it be able to release it? If the charge is given to it, how is the potential of that conductor? How is the electric field of that conductor? That is what we are going to concentrate upon. Okay, so we'll get started. I'll just read out the points that are given in the textbook. Okay, these are the basic points which you already know, but you can listen to it. So generally, conductors and insulators are the two materials we mainly concentrate upon. What are conductors? Conductors contain mobile charge carriers. So what do you mean by charge carriers? The charges which can actually flow through a conductor are what are called as charge carriers. Okay, so in metallic conductors, when you talk about the charge carriers, it is the electrons that are going to flow. So if you have a metallic conductor, it is the flow of electrons which is responsible for the electric current in it. Okay, so why is it happening? Because they have free electrons. Why do metals have free electrons? Because the number of valence electrons are less, as a result of which it is easy for us to remove the valence electron from the surface of the metal. Hence, they will participate in the process of conduction. Okay, till here everything is clear, right? So what is there? If somebody asks you, what is there inside a conductor? So how is it able to exhibit the property of conduction? It is because every conductor has free electrons associated with it. Okay, this is an important point. Please note. So every conductor has free electrons present, which do not leave the metal. They do not leave the metal. Okay, they are free to move within the conductor, but they are not free to come out of the conductor. Okay. Now, having this point in mind, we are going to see 6 important points. So inside a conductor, what is going to be the value of the electrostatic field? Okay, so what is going to be the value of the electrostatic field within a conductor? Okay, now listen, if I take a conductor in this shape, if I take a conductor in this shape, initially what will the conductor have? What will the conductor, just now we discussed,
three
electrons, right? So these free electrons are able to move within the conductor, but they cannot come out of the conductor. Now comes an important question. Just because they have free electrons, can I say every conductor in this world is negatively charged? Can I say everything is negatively charged? Think about it, no? So just now we learned that the conductor has free electrons, right? So if it has free electrons, can I say the conductor is negatively charged one? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
But actually, you cannot say. It is a no, because the free electrons have come out. Wherever the electrons have got missed, at that point, there is a positive charge. So the number of electrons that have come out will be balanced by the amount of positive charge, the deficiency of electrons at that particular location. So every conductor by default is still going to be neutral only, unless it is given excess amount of electrons. Don't get confused between these two points. Just because there are two words I'm using, I'm talking about free electrons and excess electrons. In this context, it is not the excess amount of electrons it has, it rather has free electrons. You're able to understand this point? See, the first one is very, very important, guys. Okay. So if I take a conductor and if I place it in external electric field, what is going to happen? If I place it in the external electric field, what do you think is going to happen within the conductor?
Charges will start moving.
Charges will accumulate in one side.
Why?
Sir, because electric field, there will be source charge present.
Explain this concept already.
Start moving.
So, if you will have positive charge here, you will have negative charge here, right? Because the electric field is from the positive to the negative direction. This is the external electric field. Right, this external electric field will be strong enough to pierce through the conductor as well. So when it pierces through the conductor, what will happen to the free electrons is these electrons will get drifted, will get shifted to one of the sides. That is, it will get shifted towards the positive charge, as a result of which there will be some positive charge left on the other side of the conductor, right? In such a way that there is still external electric field existing inside the material. Till here, is it clear, guys?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Now see, what will happen is, since the charges have got drifted and they got fixed at a particular location, they got fixed at the ends of the conductor, due to the difference in the charges here, there will be an electric field in the opposite direction as well. You're able to understand, because wherever there is a separation, wherever there is charge, there will be an electric field that is present. Okay, so here the electric field will be inside the conductor, which I will call it as EIN, which is called as the induced electric field. Okay, so the process of this drifting will take place till an extent where the external electric field is exactly equal to the induced electric field. So what is going to be the net electric field inside? So when I talk about the net electric field, it is the value of E external plus E induced. So E external and E induced are in, actually I have to put a vector symbol for it. E external and E induced are in opposite direction, as a result of which the net electric field inside a conductor is always zero. So have this point in your mind. So this is the first important point, and that's the heading. Inside a conductor, the electrostatic field is zero.
Sir, inside the conductor, initially there are only electrons present, then how did the positive charge come, sir?
Because there is deficiency of electrons, no? All the negative charge is concentrated on one of the sides, right? All the negative charge got concentrated on one side, means wherever electrons are not there, it will have positive charge.
So the electric field is producing the charge here, right, sir?
Electric field is produced due to the induced charges. See, the arrangement is not taking place on its own. It is taking place because you placed it in an external electric field. Is this point clear, guys? The whole concept runs only on this one, this point.
Yes, sir.
I have a doubt.
Tell me.
How can we conclude the magnitude of the electric field are equal, sir?
This will happen. This is the process that will happen. Because, see, if this external electric field was not equal to the induced electric field, what would have happened is there would have been an unbalanced force acting.
Yes, sir.
There would have been an unbalanced force acting, as a result of which the electrons would have started experiencing force. Now tell me the sequence, no? If the electrons experience force, then what will happen to them? They will accelerate. If they accelerate, obviously they have velocity. If the velocity is there, the condition is no more electrostatic. The condition will become electrodynamic because the particles are moving.
Yes.
But what did we say? We told the electrostatic field inside a conductor is zero. Means a conductor, we are talking about the charges at rest. You're able to understand?
Yes, sir, I understood.
Sir. So there can be a situation where the electrons are moving though, sir, when the electric field are not same.
They will not move. See, they will move and come to a rest. It is not like they're continuously moving. Try to understand the difference, okay? You can say electric current is constituted in a conductor. Listen to this carefully, okay? This is what we are going to discuss in next chapter. If somebody asks you, when can you say electric current is constituted? Only when it forms a circuit. If you talk about an open circuit, what is going to happen? The electrons will move, but it will stop. You cannot call that situation as electric current. You're able to understand. That is, when you have an open circuit, you cannot call it as an electric current. The situation is something similar to that, but it is not an open circuit or something like this. There is not a circuit at all. Imagine this mobile is a conductor. This mobile is placed in external electric field. See, we are present in the influence of gravitational field. Let's say, using some situation, I remove the gravitational field and I am in a place where electric field is there. In that electric field, I have a conductor in my hand. I held it like this. Okay, I hold it like this. Then what will happen? If the electric field is in this way, inside this conductor, there are three electrons. Okay, that electric field is strong enough to pierce through this material as well. Like how the radiations pass through our body. Right, the electric field will be able to pass through this material. Those free electrons which were randomly moving, okay, they will have some random motion. What would have happened to them? Those electrons would have experienced what? The electrostatic force due to the external electric field, and they will come and stick to one end of the conductor. The electrons will come and stick to one end of the conductor. They will come on which side? Whichever side there is a positive charge due to the external electric field. That's what I wrote. And they will stop at that point. They will not move.
Understood.
So when they are not moving, if the electrons are getting stuck at one of the ends, what can you say the other end does? The other end doesn't literally mean that protons are coming and sitting. No. I am putting a positive sign here because I am saying there is deficiency of electrons due to which positive charge is there. Right? So due to that process, what will happen? There will be a reverse electric field taking place. See, this process is called as induction.
Sir.
Tell me.
Sir, so positive charge is always present in a conductor, but only when we place it in an external electric field, we'll be able to experience it, sir.
I'll not say we'll be able to experience. I will say this kind of an arrangement will take place.
Okay, sir.
Okay, let me give you an introduction since you people are asking this. See, generally inside a conductor, free electrons are there, no? Those free electrons, what do you think they will do? Do you think they are going to be at rest or they will be in motion?
Motion, sir.
They will be. Okay. But the question is, when they are in motion, why don't we say that conductor, see, if I take a wire, For example, I have my laptop wire connected here. It is switched off. Can I say that the electrons, the current is flowing through this?
My laptop.
I can't say no, but you are saying that charges are moving inside this. Then what? How do you say that? Then how are the charges supposed to move?
Inside.
Then they should be at rest, no?
Yes.
Inside this conductor, they should be at rest, no? Yes or no? I'm asking a question.
Yes, sir. Yes, they should be at rest, sir. But they are not at rest only.
No, but the fact is, they will not be at rest because we have a room temperature. No, due to the room temperature, the free electrons inside will have motion, but in random direction. Something like a Brownian movement. How the gas molecules move? No, you know what is a Brownian movement, right? They have motion in some random direction, such that the net average velocity gets cancelled out. That's what is actually present inside a conductor when it is not present in the external electric field. Whereas when you bring an external electric field, immediately what will happen? There will be an alignment taking place. And that alignment is what I've drawn here with the negative charge on the left and the positive charge on the right.
Yes, sir.
I hope you're able to visualize it, right? See, unfortunately, yes. I can't show these things, but try to understand. Yeah. So this is an important
point. I have a doubt in this. So the external electric field is uniform, sir. Yeah?
Yes.
So this is applicable only for a uniform external electric field or for any?
See, in this case I have taken, it is not applicable only in the case of uniform. If suppose there was a non-uniform electric field, what would have happened is the alignment, the negative charges and positive charges would have got aligned in such a way that the induced electric field would exactly be a counterpart of the external electric field.
So it will arrange itself accordingly.
Under any situation, what we can say is, under any situation, you can say one important point that the electric field inside a conductor is by default zero. Means the electric field lines cannot pass through the conductor. I'm talking about the net electric field lines. Okay, here they should have added a word like this. The net electric field inside a conductor is zero.
Yes, understood.
Okay. Next. Second onwards, it is easy. The first point alone is like that. So, at the surface of a charged conductor, when I say charged conductor, what do I mean?
That means the electrons are protons. They are not equal.
What protons are? Electrons are deficient or excess. That's it. Speak only about electrons. So, at the surface of a charged conductor, we can say that the electrostatic field is always normal to the surface. Is always normal to the surface. Why? That is, see, listen to this point again, okay? So I have a conductor. It is not necessary that conductor should always have a fixed shape. It's taking some random shape like this. What is the point? If somebody has textbook, please read it out. What are they saying? At the surface of the conductor, of a charged conductor, electrostatic field must be normal to the surface at every point. So what do I mean by normal to the surface at every point?
Perpendicular.
So how do I draw perpendicular for a curved surface?
Perpendicular to the tangent.
Very good. So I need to draw a tangent at every point, and to the tangent the electric field is perpendicular. That is what they are stating. That is a statement. That is the second property of electrostatics of conductor. Now we will raise a question. Why is it so? Why should it be like this? Right? So, there will be an important point that will come, guys. So, what did the first point say? Listen the way I'm connecting the dots, okay? The first point told the net electrostatic field inside a conductor is zero. Correct? So, net electrostatic field inside whom? Inside a conductor. Please underline the word conductor, because we'll be learning about this in insulator also. Is zero. If that is the case, then if I try to give charge to this material, where do you think the charge will go and sit?
On the surface.
It should go and sit on the surface. There is one more point also, I think third or fourth point. There we will say that the charges will reside only on the surface. Okay. As of now, accept it. Let's say the charge is going and sitting on the surface. Okay. We should have one point in our mind always, that we are dealing with electrostatics. when will there be a violation of electrostatics taking place?
When the charges are not
charges move.
Charges are in motion, that's it. If they attain velocity, then the principle of electrostatics is violated, that's it, right? See, what would have happened is, let's say this positive charge is there, no? If this is the surface, I drew a tangent and I'm saying the electric field is not perpendicular to the surface. I say electric field is making an angle theta with the tangent drawn at that particular point. Then what can you do with this electric field? You can resolve it into two components. What are the two components? One is going to be E cos theta. Second will be E sin theta. Right? So, if E cos theta had been existing, then what do you think would have happened to the so-called positive charge that is residing on the surface?
Move.
They will start experiencing a force of how much value? It will experience a force of QE cos theta. Right? If this is not equal to zero, then I can say that the charges are moving on the surface of the conductor. If that kind of a scenario occurs, can I say that the electrostatics is violated? The principle of electrostatics is violated? In order for that principle to be existing as it is, then what should have happened? QE cos theta should have been zero. If it is equal to zero, cos theta should be zero. Then what should be the value of theta? It should be 90 degrees. And this is the reason why the electric field is always perpendicular to the surface of the conductor. At which point? At every point. At every point of
the surface. Okay. Sir, the resolution of vectors only, how did you take it for that electric field, sir? E sin theta, E cos theta.
This is the electric field. This is the tangent, theta. If this is electric field, any component
close. It should be perpendicular.
Yes, sir. E sin theta is perpendicular to tangent. So E cos theta is along the tangent. E sin theta is perpendicular to tangent. And E is the resultant. Try to understand the difference. Here E is perpendicular. But in this case, I took not being perpendicular to prove that theta is 90 degrees. Everyone is clear. Right. We'll go to the next topic. Third is what? The interior of the conductor can have no excess charge in which condition? In the static situation. Simple again. How do we prove it? So what is the third point saying? If I take a conductor, inside the conductor, there should be no excess charge present. Under what conditions? Under static condition. Again, let us say, there is a Gaussian surface existing just below the surface of the conductor. Okay, I'm repeating it again. I've taken a dotted lines, which is called as the Gaussian surface, which is exactly the shape of the conductor. Where did I take it? I took it just below the surface. Okay. If I apply Gauss law, then what am I going to get? E into ds, or forget about surface integral of E ds also. The electric field multiplied with area should be equal to 1 by epsilon naught times. What is the total charge present inside? It is Q enclosed. No? Are you guys able to understand this point? This is from the concept of Gauss law. But what did the first point tell us? Electric field is
zero inside the
zero under static condition. If I substitute E is equal to zero here, then what will you get the value of charge enclosed as?
Zero.
Zero. So if charge enclosed is zero, where does the excess charge go and sit then? There is no possibility of you having
options.
They have to sit exactly on the surface of the conductor. Okay, so that's what the third point says. What does the third point state? the excess charge in static condition within a conductor cannot exist, and they will go and sit only on the surface of the conductor. So whatever I am giving you as a mathematical proof here will be given as statement. If you want, you can read and see. Okay, if you want, you can read this and see. They would have spoken about Gauss law, but mathematical conditions would have not been given. So this is the important point. There is no net charge at any point inside the conductor. Any excess charge given to the conductor must reside only on the surface of the conductor. Is it clear, guys? Shall I proceed?
Yes, sir.
Good. Now we will go to the next one, fourth one. So the fourth condition says, electrostatic potential is constant throughout the volume of the conductor and has the same value as inside on its surface. So this is an important point. Electric field inside a conductor is zero, but what are they trying to say about electrostatic potential? Electrostatic potential is not zero, rather it is a constant value till where? Till its surface. Why is it happening? Anybody with a proof? Again, a conductor. If I take the electric field inside a conductor is zero, but the potential inside a conductor is not equal to zero. And the reason is very simple. Yesterday we saw a derivation. What is it? E is equal to minus dV divided by dr. Electric field is a negative of potential gradient. No. What did we say about the electric field? It is zero inside a conductor. Is equal to minus dV divided by dr. Now tell me one thing, guys. Derivative of what function is going to be a zero? Derivative of a constant is going to be zero. From this I can conclude that V is constant inside and on the surface of the conductor. Okay, this is also a very, very important point. Unfortunately, you don't apply it at many places. There is a device called a Vandegraaff generator that works on this principle only. That's not there in your syllabus. Okay. So I can give you an example for this. You know what is the electric field due to a spherical shell? So if I have a spherical shell, it's a conductor. Right, where does the charge go and sit? It sits only on the surface, right? So what is the electric field here? What is the electric field inside this? Is it not zero?
Zero.
Zero, right? If I take the radius of this spherical shell to be r and q to be the total charge on the surface, remember the potential on the surface of the conductor of the spherical shell is q divided by 4 pi epsilon naught r, and this is the same value as inside also. That is the point. How this has come, it is not our headache as of now, accept it. If you want, I will explain in detail, because we need to do some integration, let's not waste time on that. Okay, why it is so, you need not worry about. Okay, it is q divided by 4 pi epsilon naught r, which are, it is capital R. And that is the same value inside the conductor also. Clear? I hope you guys made a note of it.
Yes. I have a doubt.
So, sir, wait, sir.
So, this is the same as normal potential formula, right? Kq by r.
Yeah, it is kq by r only, but what r will use? That is for a point charge. There the value of r you are using is a variable. Here capital R is a constant.
Here R is constant. Okay, sir, I understand.
Done.
Yes, sir.
Let's see what is the next point. If you talk about the magnitude of the electric field at any point on the surface of the charged conductor, it is always given by the value sigma divided by epsilon naught. Okay. So we saw two important points. Electric field inside is zero, And the second important point is electric field on the surface is always perpendicular to the surface. Now the third important point with respect to electric field is electric field value on the surface of a conductor is always sigma divided by epsilon naught, and this n cap stands for normal vector. Wherever in physics format, if you see n with a cap on top of it, that is a symbol used for normal vector. Okay, n stands for normal. Okay, let's see what is the derivation of this. Okay, where sigma is what? Sigma is the surface charge density, that is the charge density on the surface, and n cap is a unit vector normal to the surface in the outward direction. This we already know, right? So I will read out what is given here. It is also based on Gauss law only, a simple derivation, but let me tell you what are all the steps that are used. So to derive the result, you need to choose a pill box. Pill box is nothing but a short cylinder as the Gaussian surface about any point P on the surface. Let's say there is a point P on the surface of the conductor and there is a small pill box that is taken. So the pill box is taken, the cylinder is taken in such a way that it is partially outside, and this is the surface of the conductor, no? The pill box will be like this. You're able to understand? So some surface will be outside, some will be inside. Okay. Now what we'll do is we will take this surface area to be delta S. Okay, this surface area.
Sir, the conductor again, can you explain it, sir? How is it placed?
Right. This is a, let's say this is the cylinder. Okay. Let's say this finger is my surface. It is taken like this. See, I can take the pill box like this, or I can take the pill box like this. But here it is chosen in such a way that half portion is outside and half is inside.
The conductor placed through the cylinder, also.
Yeah, conductor. So this cylinder is actually going through the conductor.
What material is it, sir? Solid.
See, Gaussian surface is the imaginary surface, right? It is not like you're taking the cylinder and inserting it. Correct? There's only a surface to find out something mathematically. Okay. So for the cylinder, you will have a flat surface, no? The area of that flat surface is taken as delta S. Okay. Now tell me one thing. What does Gauss law state? Electric field multiplied with the area is equal to 1 by epsilon naught times the charge enclosed by that area. So what is going to be the charge enclosed by the area? It will be sigma into the area of the conductor. Sigma into delta S. So delta S and delta S will get cancelled. The value of electric field will be sigma divided by epsilon naught. We can confidently put an n cap because we know from the second point that the electric field is normal to the surface. So this is an important point. You have to have it in your mind.
Can you say for what this formula is used for? To find what this formula is used for.
Somebody asked me what is the value of electric field on the surface of any conductor? It is sigma by epsilon naught. That's it.
So what is delta S, sir?
Delta S is area.
Okay, sir.
I just use a symbol that is given here. You need not take it as delta S. You can just take it as area also.
Okay, sir.
So it's this thing, small area of cross section, delta S, and negligible height. Right. Shall I move on to the next one? The last point that we are going to see is electrostatic shielding. Okay. Suppose you consider a conductor with a cavity with no charges inside the cavity. You know what is a cavity, right? Cavity is an empty space, right? So we are going to consider a conductor with cavity with no charges inside the cavity. So what you can understand is the result, it's a hollow thing, something like this. Okay, this is a cavity. This is a cavity. Okay. So the result that you can obtain is the electric field inside a cavity is also zero, whatever be the shape and size. It is purely because there is no charge present. So when you talk about a conductor, so where is the cavity present? You have a conductor. Okay, you have a cavity inside the conductor. So the cavity is present inside the conductor. Now let's answer a logical question. What is the electric field inside a conductor? It is zero.
Zero.
Cavity itself is inside the conductor. Again, the electric field is going to be zero. That is one way to see. Or the other way to understand is, we know that no charge is going to be present within the conductor. When there is no charge within the conductor itself, obviously there will be no charge within the cavity also. So using Gauss law, you can prove that the electric field inside a conductor is again zero. So are you able to understand?
Yes, sir.
That is the meaning. This whole thing, whole story is what I explained in one point. Okay. So the best example for this is when you have when there is some lightning. Okay. Let's say when there is some lightning, there will be a question like this: is it safe for you to stand under a tree or sit inside a car?
Sit inside car, sir.
The car conductor, sir. So
metal sheet, no?
Metal transfer. It transfer the.
So electric charge won't go inside the car because it's a conductor.
Reason is, car will provide a car has a principle called as electrostatic shielding. That's it. Because car outside is a metal surface, inside it is like a cavity. So when it is inside like a cavity, then there is no electric field inside, so you're safe. Okay. So why we call it as electrostatic shielding is because shielding means what? It is like a protection, right? So it is protecting us from the electrostatic field or electric field. That is the reason why we call it as electrostatic shield. So where can this be applied? This effect can be used in protecting sensitive instruments from outside the electrical influence. So if you want to protect any device, if you think there is some device which will immediately react to the external electric field, you can always keep it inside a cavity. That's the meaning. Okay. For example, we sitting inside a car is an example. So this example, I am leaving it to you guys. You guys go through it. Okay. Is there any doubt? So I hope you guys understood the electrostatics of conductor.
Yes.
Right. So there is a reason why we studying this. So before I explain what is a dielectric and what is meant by polarization, let me give you a brief introduction of where exactly this is applicable. Okay. If suppose, see, till now we were talking about one thing, charge, right? So if I put a question like this, you tell me yes or no, that's enough. If I put a question like this, is it possible for us to create charge? Is it possible for us to create charge? Can you create charge?
No,
sir.
You're taking that conservation, no? That a charge can neither be created nor be destroyed. I'm not talking about that. Can you charge a material is what I'm asking.
Yes, sir.
It by doing what? Two principles are there. You can use either an external electric field and induce the charges in it, or you rub it against the surface, frictional electricity will get created. Okay. So you can create a charge on a material, accepted. Second important point is, whatever charge you have created, no, if you think it has a future purpose, then what are we supposed to do with that charge? If you think, if you have created something, that, okay,
we
created,
have to remove the charge somewhere. You have to remove the charge and store it somewhere.
You have to store it. No, to put it in simple terms, you need to preserve it. If you think something is valuable, you are going to preserve it. In this case, it is charge. So if you feel the charge you have created is valuable and you want to preserve it so that you can use it in the future whenever you need, then you need a device for it. Obviously, right? So what is one of the devices which you people already know which can store charge?
Battery.
Simple thing is a battery, right? Battery has a charge stored in it, and that charge will use it whenever we need. For example, the TV remote example that we discussed on the other day. You are connected, your remote is going to work. It will provide the energy. Now, the next question is, apart from battery, is there a possibility of me devising another device, me having another device, which I can so that it can store charge. The device is called as a capacitor. Okay, so you think of a water bottle. Okay, so this water bottle, if I read the specification, I am able to see it is 750 ml water, right? Obviously this has a capacity of how much value?
750 ml
in terms of volume. Similarly, I have this water bottle. When I bought it, I remember it is 500 ml water bottle. Okay, though it looks big inside, there is some material which can hold only 500 ml. So every material, for example, I take the sanitizer bottle. The sanitizer bottle capacity is 190 ml. Means that is the amount of storage it can have. Similarly, if you think of a device, instead of having water inside it, if you can give charge to it, that device is what is called as a capacitor. And that device will have a capacity associated with it. We don't use the word capacity. Rather, we use a technical name called as capacitance. You're able to understand?
Yes.
Sir, capacitance is the property of the capacitor.
Property of the material to hold charge. The property of the material. Something that ends with A and C, that is a grammar, okay? Capacitor, capacitance. Okay, if you see the prefix OR, generally resistor OR, it's a device. Resistance A and C, it's a property. Conductor OR is a device. Conductance is a property. You're able to understand? Inductor, inductance. Something like this. So capacitor is a device, and capacitance is the property of the device. Now, I'm getting many questions in my mind. Okay, I've learned something called as capacitor. If that is how, so if that is called as a device which can store charge, then what are all the materials I need to think of? Then I need to do a small analysis and research to understand the capacitor should be made up of what kind of a material? Anybody?
Insulator.
Why not insulator, a conductor? Why not
semi.
A
conductor? Sir, because it charges will.
Semiconductor is electronics, sir.
Sir, if you store in a conductor and if you expose in external electric field, polarization will occur, sir. So storing an insulator won't lead to any changes.
Storing an insulator will not require. No, that's not the answer. To answer your question, capacitors basically are nothing but conductors only. Capacitors are conductors only. Okay, if suppose I have this paper, okay, so this envelope is there, it is something similar to a plane sheet. In the second chapter, in the first chapter, we learned something called as electric field due to a plane sheet. I give charge this side and this side, I will have electric fields, right? So if I take one conductor like this and another conductor like this, and if I separate them and place it like this, this particular combination is what is called as a capacitor. I can show you how it works also. We can actually design our own capacitor. If time permits, one day I will show you. I'll have a special class on that. Okay, you can design your own capacitor at home with all the with a small paper, you can do it. And you can see the charge also, trust me. Okay, if I take this conductor and this conductor, if I place them close by like this, then this kind of a setup is what is called as a conductor. Sorry, a capacitor. You're able to understand? Means I can give charges to these devices and I can make them store. Now comes an important question. If that is the case, then I don't need any concept called as insulator, right? Then I don't need the concept of insulator, because I told you capacitors are nothing but two conductors. Then what do you think? Do you think it will completely be an advantage, or is there any disadvantage of you giving the charges to the conductor and just forgetting about them? What do you think the conductors will do?
Sir, it will try to get stable, sir. So if it's stable, it has no charge.
Stable? Let us see. What do you think? I'll put a question very simple like that. Let's say I'm giving charge to this surface. This is what, according, see, paper is actually an insulator. Sir, yeah. Current, for the time being, assume this is an aluminium foil. Aluminium is a metal and that will be a conductor. Okay, aluminium foil or that. If I give charge on the aluminium foil, then I give charge to another aluminium foil. If I hold them together, I can still call it as a capacitor. What is the work of a capacitor? Let's think of it logically. Okay, capacitor should store charge. Correct? So if it has to store charge, I've already given charges to these conductors. But do you think that charge is going to exist on the conductor for a long duration?
No, sir.
No, sir.
Wait.
Sir, it stabilizes atmosphere.
Perfect. Because conductors have the tendency of losing charges easily, because they conduct, no, they respond to the atmosphere, and what they do is the charges which are present on the surface immediately get leaked to the surface. That is the reason why you can never replace a capacitor with a battery. Had that been the scenario, capacitors are cheaper than battery. This is the size of a capacitor. I'll show you next class. Okay, this is the size of a capacitor. If capacitor is so strong, then they would have replaced batteries by now. Okay, they can store charge, but they are used for some other purpose. What purpose, we will see later. But as of now, I want you to understand what is the principle of a capacitor. You are able to understand? If you guys are able to think why we are actually learning about a capacitor, it's not like just like that you are learning about. Okay, so have this in your mind. Capacitors are nothing but two conductors. If I have two conductors separated, if I give one conductor a positive charge and the other conductor a negative charge, and I keep a certain amount of distance of separation between them, then this kind of an arrangement is what is called as a capacitor. But this arrangement will not be sufficient enough to obtain the results which we expect, because conductors have the property to lose charge to the surrounding. That is, this process is called as leakage of charge. You would have heard about this thing, no, battery leaking. Means what would have happened? The electrolyte inside would have got leaked. Sometimes, no, it happened with me last week. When I touched the battery, I could feel the wetness of it. The electrolyte got leaked. You're able to understand? In a similar way, to overcome this disadvantage of a conductor, we need to use an intermediate medium between them. Between this conductor and this conductor, there is air medium, no? Air itself is a good conductor because there is something called as breakdown. It will immediately get converted into a conductor and it will lose the charges. So for that to be avoided, what we need to do is, between this conductor and this conductor, I need to use an insulator. And that insulator is what is technically called as a dielectric. You're able to understand? So what are dielectrics? Dielectrics are basically non-conducting substances. So in contrast to the conductors, they have no or negligible number of charge carriers. That is, they do not have anything like free electrons. Okay. Now we will understand one important point, guys. I told you a point already. So the first one is a conductor and the second one is a dielectric. When you place, okay, listen to this carefully. So inside a conductor, you have free electrons. So when the conductor is placed in an external electric field, what would have happened? There will be the external electric field present inside, which is E naught, and there will be an
inside electric field inside, zero.
Such that the net electric field is zero. Right? So this is sigma free means the surface charge density of the free electrons. This is the surface charge density, that is a positive charge created due to the free electrons. Whereas in an insulator, what will happen is the electric field will get pierced. Okay, and what do you think dielectrics are made up of? So if insulators, dielectrics, only
neutral charge, sir.
The conductor, inside a conductor there are free electrons, sir. Similarly, inside a dielectric, what do you think are present?
Anybody? Static electrons.
Sorry?
Static electrons.
They will have small dipoles inside them. We learned about dipoles in the previous chapter, no? Inside an insulator, there are dipoles present. And how are the dipoles going to be present? Listen to this. Okay. If I take this as an insulator, then it will have small dipoles like this. What is a dipole? System of a positive and a negative charge separated by a very small distance. Right? You will have negative charge here, positive charge here. Negative charge, positive charge. Something like this. I'm randomly drawing, okay? We need not sit and analyze this. So the dipole should be present in such a way that they will be randomly arranged. You're able to understand? So when this kind of a system, where it has system of dipoles, is placed in external electric field, what do you think will happen? We have learned everything in the previous chapter. When a dipole,
if a torque acting on
dipole, will experience a torque.
It will start experiencing a torque. Okay, it will experience a torque, and the the dipoles inside the dielectric will get arranged in such a way that the negative charge will be on the left hand side and the positive charge will be on the right hand side. So this kind of a scenario occurs. Are you able to understand?
Yes, sir.
So this will be the direction of external electric field. Since, see, in the case of conductors, what happened is the surface itself was empty. See, here also observe one important point. The negative charge is still concentrated on the left hand side. The positive charge is still concentrated on the right hand side. Okay, calculate the total charge here. It is going to be zero. Okay, if I take this positive charge to be present here, and if I take the negative charge to be present here, can I say that there is an induced electric field inside? Can I say
yes.
there is an induced electric field inside? But here comes an important question. In this case, is the induced electric field equal to the external electric field? The answer is
no, because the only less electrons.
Because there is some blockage. It is something like friction. No, there is some resistance because there is material present. The induced electric field has to get pierced through all these dipoles and come. So obviously, what will happen is the external electric field and the induced electric field can never become equal in terms of magnitude, but they are always opposite direction. Okay. In this case, I can write E external minus E induced is equal to a non-zero value. If it is a non-zero value, then what is the exact value of it? Anybody? Is equal to the external electric field divided by something called as kappa, K-A-P-P-A. It's a Greek letter. It's written like this. In chemistry, you will see under electrochemistry chapter. Okay, it's called kappa. Anybody with an idea of what is this kappa? This is called as dielectric constant. Have you heard this word, anyone? In your school, they would have taught.
No, sir.
They didn't use this word at all.
First lesson.
We don't know, sir.
No problem. There is a term called as dielectric constant, or it is also called as relative permeability. So it's called as relative permeability. One of the symbols used is kappa, and some books use epsilon r. Epsilon stands for permittivity, r stands for relative. Okay. Now tell me one thing. Is there anyone having doubt with this concept? This is very, very important because
sir,
you need to tell me.
Sir, why external field is not equal to the induced field only? I didn't understand.
It is because there is some opposition offered. Because, see, in the case of a conductor, you didn't have any blocking materials like these dipoles. You had only one thing inside a conductor. What was that? Inside a conductor, you had free electrons. So, if there is a conductor, if all the free electrons get shifted, if they get, let's say there is a magnet like this, all these electrons came and got stuck here, then what is this all about? What is present inside the conductor? Is it not free space?
Yes, sir.
So the induced electric field, is it experiencing any opposition inside a conductor due to the free space? Is it experiencing any opposition?
No, sir.
That is the reason why induced electric field is equal to the external electric field in that case. Whereas here, what is present inside a dielectric? It's a dipole. And
okay,
the induced electric field have to overcome the intermediate dipoles to reach from the positive end to the negative end. Puri da? So that is the reason why here, if you
yes,
observe
sir.
The so. So that's how they symbolically represent. Generally, whenever vectors are there, no, the size of the arrow mark will tell you which has greater magnitude. Here, if you observe, E naught is greater than E in. So they have given E naught plus E in is equal to is not equal to zero. See, one point I would like to tell you guys. E naught with an arrow mark is the same as E naught. If something is written in bold, here if you observe, it is in bold, means it's a vector quantity. Okay, so don't take them like scalars and then write it. Don't get confused with them. It's not equal to zero, and they have given no. That zero is what I'm trying to say. In this case, E naught minus E in is equal to E naught divided by kappa, where the kappa is called as the dielectric constant or relative permittivity. Now I'm going to explain about what exactly that relative permittivity means. Okay, so in physics, relative means comparison. You would have seen this: relative velocity, relative density, relative refractive index. So relative means comparison. So when I say comparison, there are two types of comparison you can do. One comparison in terms of subtraction, one comparison in terms of division. I'll give you the best example for it. If somebody asks you what is relative velocity, what will you say? If I ask you VAB, it is VA minus VB. That is relative comparison. If I ask you what is relative density, what will you say? It is the density of the substance by density of water at 4 degrees Celsius. If you don't remember, also no issue. It is the density of substance by density of water at 4 degrees Celsius. So here also it is relative, here also it is relative. So it can either be subtraction or division. In this case of relative permeability, it is defined like this. It is defined as the ratio of permittivity of a medium to the permittivity of free space. So please write it down. Please write it down. Relative permeability means it is a ratio of permeability of free space. Sorry. The ratio of permeability of a medium to
a permeability of permittivity, sir.
Did I use permeability? I'm extremely sorry. Permeability is used for magnetism. Thank you for correcting. I missed it. Sorry. Permittivity. Thank you. So it's called permittivity of a medium to the permittivity of free space. Clear? So this is also called as kappa. Okay.
The ratio of permittivity of a medium to
permittivity of free space. You know what is the permittivity of free space? No, epsilon naught is 8.85 into 10 power minus 12. This I hope you know.
Yes, sir.
So you do a comparison of an unknown quantity with a known quantity. That is the thing. Okay. So this is all about the basics of dielectrics. Okay, I have not yet gone into the depth of it. So next class we will be discussing about how these dielectrics help increase the capacitance of a conductor. Before that, we need to see what is capacitance. I'll come to that point. But I hope everyone is clear with why we are studying this concept. That is more important for me. You need to have a clarity. You're able to understand, everyone?
Yes.
Sir. I'm saying why we need the concept of dielectrics. It is because made up of conductors, and conductors leak the charge to the surrounding. To overcome that, we need a storage device that is a dielectric. Okay. How to design and what are all the designs of a capacitor, I'll explain it in the next class. Maximum two more classes, we are done with this chapter. Okay. So if there is any doubt in the meanwhile, you guys can reach out to me. Okay. I'll see you guys in the next class. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you,
sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Excuse me.